Our next inductee spent several years at the MM Constitution before moving to the Wall Street Journal. We cannot go without saying he is a Pulitzer Prize winning author for General Nonfiction. Our next inductee this evening, Doug Glenn.
Inductee, Atlanta Press Club, Hall of Fame.
ladies and gentlemen, please welcome former Acting Attorney General Sally Yates.
Much to be able to take in all at one time. in unearthing this shameful chapter of our history that had somehow been buried along with the lives that had been cast aside. He confronted us not only with what we're capable of inflicting on one another, but also what we're capable of forgetting. Through endless, tedious research and dusty courthouse basements all across the South, Doug rendered denial of the truth impossible. He did it not just by confronting us with a cumulative narrative, but he also brought us face to face with the individuals whose inhuman fate burned through the pages with searing and vivid detail. In telling us this truth, Doug afforded the long-denied respect and dignity due the men who, in Doug's words, nobody had given a damn about over 100 years ago when they were alive. Well, Doug gave a damn about. He gave voice to the voiceless, and he would not let us look away. In confronting us with our past, he's given us a gift too, a gift for which we owe him our thanks, and that is the opportunity to see our own blemishes. Doug's done his job, and now what we do with that opportunity, now whether we work to heal, whether we, in Doug's words, live up to the true American exceptionalism and work together to build an America that truly matches our ideals, but that's up to all of us. It's my great privilege to introduce to all of you Douglas A. Blackmon.
I'll actually say something more about my mother. She's not just my mother, she's also the person who taught me to read. Because I was a little boy in the first grade in a little town in Mississippi who didn't learn to read as well as I should have. And so at the end of first grade, my mother, who was a school teacher herself, at the end of first grade when they were considering whether to hold me back, it's always a good story, the Pulitzer Prize winner couldn't read. But instead of holding me back, she took the Jack and Jill reader that I had not been able to master in the first grade, which I still have. And over the summer after that first grade year, she sat with me every day, read with me, made me read, she taught me to read. She was no ordinary person. Is an ordinary person, but in particular in the world that I grew up in a little town in rural Mississippi, she and my father both, they were fresh off the farm people who came into adulthood freighted with all of the same baggage that almost all white people coming off the farm were freighted with in those days. They had their own views about race that they had never challenged, or views they had never considered, but they were no ordinary white people, because they were willing to reconsider so much of the world around them, and they insisted that I and my brothers do the same thing. And so in this time, a great change in those years, they were voices of the need for change. And so a few years after that year in which she taught me to read, when I was in seventh grade, exactly 40 years ago now, there was an essay contest announced in our county, sponsored by the County Historical Society, which is a synonym for a bunch of little old rich white ladies. The essay contest allowed any student in any school in the county to write an essay about any topic related to the history of the county. And I wrote an essay about a civil rights incident that had occurred in 1965, where a group of black families went on strike against a plantation right on the edge of our town, and ultimately formed an encampment that became a place called Strike City. And those strikers, in fact, there's one of them left who's still out there living in that same place. And so I wrote a little essay about that story, a childish thing, really, in 1977. I then was one of the winners of the essay contest, went to the county fair for the award ceremony. It was the first time I ever received any note of distinction for my writing. Got to the county fair. When I introduced myself to the organizer, she looked at me with a combination of surprise and horror. And I don't know if I realized it instantly or if it came to me later, but the combination of it in her mind, because I went to a public school. Schools had finally integrated in Mississippi, and I was still in the public schools as almost no white children were. And so in her mind, I was a kid from an all-black school who'd written on a topic that only black people would have discussed in that time, and the oddity of my last name. I was supposed to be the black kid getting a prize that morning. So you count me as the first white child you've ever known of to exploit somebody else's affirmative action. But after I got that prize, and this is the point of it, my mother knew the work that I had done on that. She knew I'd gone to the library and done research, actually gone back and read the newspaper stories from when those events occurred, which was only about 10 years earlier, but to me, must have been 100 years earlier. But she knew what I'd done, and she knew that I hadn't finished, that I hadn't done all of the work that I intended to do. And so even after I got this prize, she said to me, you know, I hope you'll finish that story. I hope you'll finish the work that you started on. Part of me said, dang it, Mom, I just got a prize. But eventually, I took to heart what she said, and I realized that it's not enough. It's not enough for any of us as journalists, certainly not enough for me. It's not enough to fill the space or to fill the screen or to entertain the audience that we have. We have to finish the story. And there are a lot of stories I haven't finished. There are a lot of things I've done that I've been disappointed in. But I've always wanted to finish the story, and finish the story in a way that does justice to the story, does justice to the subjects, maybe does it in a way that actually changes things for someone, changes the lives of someone. Maybe even saves a few lives, maybe stops a really bad person from becoming a treacherously bad leader, which is something we have to be very concerned about now. But finishing this story, that's what I've been trying to do for